U.S. Secretary of State Mike Pompeo remains adamant that all of the evidence undeniably shows that Iran is absolutely responsible for the attack on Saudi oil facilities. Pompeo was in Saudi Arabia building a coalition to deter Iranian threats. And while speaking to the media before he returned home, Pompeo softened his tone to reflect that of President Trump, saying that the U.S. wants a peaceful resolution to this crisis. Iran's foreign minister, however, is hardening his tone, warning that any kind of attack on Iran will result in all-out war.
What would be the consequence of an American or a Saudi military strike on Iran now?
An all-out war.
You make a very serious statement there, sir.
Well, I make a very serious statement about defending our country. I'm making a very serious statement that we don't want war. We don't want to engage in a military confrontation. We believe that a military confrontation based on deception is awful, will have a lot of casualties. But we won't blink to defend our territory.
Joining me now, Matt Brodsky, a senior fellow with the Security Studies Group, and Dr. Iman Farrukhan, chairman of the board for the Iran Liberation Congress. Thank you both for being with us. Iman, Iran threatening an all-out war. There has been some kind of speculation that a reasonable retaliation for the Saudi oil facility attack would be the U.S. or the Saudis taking out some kind of Iranian target, but not in Iran proper, perhaps in Syria or Iraq. Do you really think Tehran is going to make good on that threat?
Hi, Michelle. Our belief is that the Islamic Republic, they are looking for any and every excuse to start a war, because that's the last thing that is left for them. Their economy is in shambles, and they're thinking, and their think tanks are thinking in Revolutionary Guard, that if there is some kind of a war, perhaps they may get some leverage in some negotiations, peace negotiations and whatever. We have news, as you know, that Qasem Soleimani of the Quds forces has been this week in Iraq. Maybe he still is, and he's actually ordering the terrorist groups that he supports to start attacking U.S. Properties and U.S. assets, because they know if they attack U.S. and maybe even Abu Dhabi, then U.S. and Saudi Arabia or whoever else, they may not have a choice but to take some military action. We hope that this doesn't happen because we believe that the Islamic Republic is actually falling down because of economy and the despair that the people are in, and there's no need for an attack by the U.S.
Right.
And so I'll pause here and I'll follow up later on. But we believe that they do want war.
All right, so they want war. They certainly seem to be itching for it with these attacks. They can't expect that the U.S. and the Saudis won't want to retaliate. But, Matt, that would be playing in Tehran's hands, as Iman is saying, if the U.S. does, in fact, take some kind of military action. So is the best approach here to do nothing and just keep up that economic pressure?
You know, the best approach is that the way deterrence works, as Israel has understood it and has exercised it, is to impose costs. And those costs need to be in military terms and in terms of personnel. So that is the calculation that Israel has made and has created a level of deterrence that works, of course, with Hezbollah separately and, of course, with Iran when it comes to Syria and Iraq. The United States is going to need to have some form of response that includes kinetic strikes, whether the U.S. plays a background role or whether it plays a lead role is something that I suppose could be determined. But the clear question in the end is that this is Iran right now without nuclear weapons. So clearly from Israel's calculations, for instance, this is something where it is better that Israel would have this war between wars before Iran has a nuclear weapon. Saudi Arabia, for instance, where the attack occurred, is going to need to make this same calculation. Israel understands that Iran will not launch an all-out war against Israel, because to do so is going to guarantee that Iran, of course, loses at this point.
Well, to Matt's point, Iman, why shouldn't the U.S. take some kind of limited action against Iran to send a message of deterrence, potentially in Syria, or even to prevent Iran from continuing to bolster its defenses?
For the last few months, as you may know, Israel and Middle Eastern countries, Persian Gulf countries, they have been attacking the Quds force locations inside Iraq and inside Syria. In fact, a couple of those locations, our teams inside on those areas, Iran Liberation Congress, have been able to actually have that information and pass it along. Here's the point, however. The level of dissatisfaction of people in Iran is so high that any attack, any trigger like that may actually result in a huge chaos and uprising. So the question that the Iran Liberation Congress and other opposition groups are working very hard and currently accelerating is to have that government inside Iran, government in shadow, and supported by government exile. Because unless there is a government that can actually hold on to the country after this any attack, which most probably will start a war, is that then we may actually, a lot of bad things will happen. Russia is waiting there and sitting, and they want to get to the warm waters of Persian Gulf. You've got China from the other side, you've got the Kurds, you've got the Baluch, you've got those people who want to break up Iran. So we have to be very careful and just don't think that if we just attack tit for tat, it's going to stop there. No. Iran wants a war because that's the way that during the Iran-Iraq wars for 8 years, they basically told their people, hey, look, we're, you know, this innocent people being attacked by the foreign forces. So unless we have a government ready to go, which we're pretty close to, we are actually asking for caution. And I think the fact that Mr. Trump is not trigger happy, that's why when Mr. Pompeo went to Iraq, Saudi Arabia, he said, well, Iran is behind it, and now they're backing it off. They need to have everything ready in case that uprising starts. We believe that something may happen the next 2 or 3 months when the downfall of the regime, but we have to be ready from all aspects. And not
Iman, you're predicting the downfall of the regime over the next 2 or 3 months from within?
Well, like I said, if a trigger happens, remember what happened to Tunisia. One person burned himself, you know, a suicide, and then the whole government country changed. So if something like an attack, especially if it's attacked to some areas inside Iran and not just the military bases, happen, people are ready. We know armed forces are ready inside Iran. We have just about in every state in Iran, we have both the Revolutionary Guards and the military that are ready to uprise. But we need to have coordination. We need to need leadership both from outside and inside. So we have to be very careful and patient and use force at the last resort. And finally, I was born in Iran 60 years ago. I'm a U.S. citizen. I've been here 45 years ago. Any attack to Iran, at the end of the day, it's the poor people of Iran that the United States supports and Saudi Arabia supports. So we want to minimize damage to Iran and Iranian people.
Dr. Iman Farhutdin, thank you so much. Matt Brodsky, always good to have you join us. Appreciate it.